each one. And we're celebrating the resurrection this morning and thankful that Jesus has risen from the dead. We weren't able to gather last week due to the weather, and we had to change locations today. And so we're just thankful that we were able to meet this morning and worship together. We're going to go over the announcements for the remainder of this week. Wednesday is our online Bible ministry, and that will be sent around on Wednesday. And then next Lord's Day, Lord willing, we'll be back at the Milton Hall at 10 o'clock for Sunday school for the children, morning service at 11. We have some updated prayer requests, and I want to also add one to our prayer request this morning. Received word that a young girl by the name of Annalise, and that would be Will and Katie's niece, she is in hospital with a very serious condition. So if you would please remember them in prayer at this time. There are some birthdays on the back of our bulletin. In the month of April, we have Levi celebrating today. Happy birthday, Levi. We have Shelley on the 13th and others along the way as the month comes. And so happy birthday to each one. May the Lord bless you. We're going to open with a word of prayer this morning and also return thanks for the offering that's been received. And so let's bow together in prayer. We'll ask Charlie if you'd lead us in prayer this morning.
Heavenly Father, we thank thee that we can worship thee this day. Lord, we thank thee that we stand in the resurrection ground. We thank thee that the price has been paid. We thank thee that we're safe in your hands. Regardless of what goes on in the world, we know there's a lot of turmoil, there's a lot of uncertainty, there's a lot of worries. But we belong to thee. Lord, we thank thee that we're secure in thee. Lord, we thank thee we look back to the cross and rejoice that our salvation is complete in thee. We don't have to add anything to it. It's complete. It's paid in full. It is finished. And as we look forward to what you're going to do in the future, we rejoice in the wonderful promises we have in thee. And we rejoice that day by day you're with us in the present. So there's not a time that we're not under your control, Lord. We know that things are under your control and you're caring for us. So, Lord, we pray that thou bless the offering that's today, bless our service. And, Lord, we pray that the gospel will go to souls that need to be saved, that people will realize the road they're on and they need to turn to thee for salvation and enjoy the wonderful life that has been promised. Christ told us in John 10:10, we come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. And there's nothing more abundant than the life that's pure and deep. So Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We're going to go to hymn number 175 and sing together, "There is a fountain filled with blood." 175, we are going to observe the Lord's table this morning, and we'll be reflecting on the cross and then switching to the resurrection. We're thankful that Jesus went to the cross for us, that he died for our sins. Let's stand as we sing 175.
Lose all their guilty stains.
firstborn. There seems by faith I saw the stream by flowing wounds supply. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die, and shall be till I die. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. When this for this being stammering tongue lies silent in the grave, then in a nobler, sweeter song I'll sing thy power to save. I'll sing thy power to save. I'll sing thy power to save. And in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing thy power to save. Amen. You may be seated. This time we're going to have some scripture readings reflecting on the cross of the Lord Jesus. We're going to begin in Matthew chapter 27.
Matthew 20, take your Bibles and turn with me to Matthew 27. We'll be reading in at verse number 33. And they were come unto the place called Golgotha, that is to say, a place of the skull. They gave him vinegar to drink, mingled with gall. And when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink. And they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots. And sitting down, they watched him there, and set up on his head his accusation written, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then were there two thieves crucified with him, one on the right hand and the other on the left. And they that passed by reviled him, wagging their heads, and saying, "Thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself. If thou be the Son of God, come down from the cross." Likewise also the chief priests mocked him with the scribes and elders, said, "He saved others, himself he cannot save. If he be the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in God, let him deliver him now, if he will have him, for he said, I am the Son of God." The thieves also which were crucified with him cast the same in his teeth.
Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land unto the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?" That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Some of them that stood there, when they heard that, said, "This man calleth for Elias." And straightway one of them ran and took a sponge and filled it with vinegar and put it on a reed and gave him to drink. The rest said, "Let be, let us see whether Elias will come to save him." When Jesus had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, and the graves were opened. And many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city and appeared unto many. Now when the centurion and they that were with him, watching Jesus, saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, "Truly, this was the Son of God." Many women were there beholding afar off, which followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering unto him, among which was Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James, and Joseph the mother of Zebedee's children, and the mother of Zebedee's children. And when the even was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph, whom also himself was Jesus' disciple. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered. When Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock. And he rolled a great stone into the door of the sepulchre and departed. And there was Mary Magdalene and the other Mary sitting over against the sepulchre. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word this morning. Long ago I saw my Savior bearing shame upon a tree. Then my heart was touched with sorrow, for I saw he bled for me. It is finished, loud he cried. Oh, what love for me he died. In my stead he bled on Calvary. Once for all, Christ rescued me. Oh, the sky was veiled in darkness. Sudden trembling shook the ground as the angry crowd was jeering, mocking Jesus all around. Then my Savior called to heaven as I saw his love anew. Oh, my Father, please forgive them, for they know not what they do. It is finished, loud he cried. Oh, what love for me he died. In my stead he bled on Calvary. Once for all, Christ rescued me. Salvation now he offers. Take his gift, oh, hear his plea. On the bloody cross behold him, join his shout of victory. It is finished, loud he cried. Oh, what love for me he died. In my stead he bled on Calvary. Once for all, Christ rescued me. Let's bow our heads as we come before the Lord's table this morning. We remember that the bread which speaks of the broken body of the Lord Jesus, the body which was taken nailed to the cruel cross, and the cup which speaks to us of the precious blood of the Lord Jesus, that without the shedding of blood there would be no remission, we would not be able to find forgiveness of sins. And that John the Baptist said, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." And so we come this morning as believers, the Lord Jesus Christ, remembering his death, till he comes or recalls us home. And so let's bow together in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you this morning for the emblem of the bread, which speaks of your body. We thank you, Lord, for what you accomplished for us on the cross. Lord, we have sung and we have read verses that speak of your death. We know it was a death that was accomplished once and for all and forever. And so we give thee thanks this morning, dear Father. We pray, Lord, that you would continue to work through us and use us for your glory. And we thank you that we can remember you in this way this morning. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Corinthians 11:23 says, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me."
Our Lord and God, we come to the table today, dear Lord, to remember what you accomplished at the cross. We know, dear Lord, that if it wasn't for you going to that cross, that we'd be all on our way to hell. We thank you, dear Lord, that you offered a way of forgiveness for us. You paid the price in full. There's nothing we can do. There's nothing we can add to it. We know, dear Lord, that it was a gift that we could never understand, how you could turn your back on your son within 3 hours. But it was necessary, dear Lord, so we could have forgiveness. And we ask, dear Lord, that as we appreciate what you've done, that we share to others. We thank you, dear Lord, for that spilt blood. We know there'd be no remission of sin if it wasn't for that spilt blood. And we thank you for it. This we pray in your precious name. Amen.
After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is a new testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come." We're going to take our Bibles and turn to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. And on the third day, Jesus rose again. And we're here to rejoice that our Savior is alive. And it says in Matthew chapter 28 and verse number 1, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake. For the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. And let's all read verse 6 together. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he goeth before you into Galilee, and there shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, all hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Then said Jesus unto them, be not afraid. Go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word as we take our songbooks and turn to hymn number 176, and we rejoice that Jesus is risen. Let's stand together. Said he is alive, he is risen. And they said, he is not here, for he is risen. Come see the place where the Lord lay. And it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, but now is Christ risen from the dead. And what a hope we have as we're going to look into the word of God in a few moments, that he is alive, and that means great changes for you and I, because he lives, we will live also. Let's sing that third verse then.
Death cannot keep his prey, Jesus, my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose with the mighty triumph. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and
377. 377. We'll sing the first and the third verse of this. I serve a risen Savior. 377.
Savior, he's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. On the third, rejoice, rejoice, O Christ. Lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart.
Amen. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Thank you, Katie. Thank you, Carl, for your ministries this morning to us. Let's take our Bibles and turn together to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8. Mark, chapter 8. And we're going to read in at verse number 27. And Jesus went out, and his disciples into the towns of Caesarea Philippi. And by the way, he asked his disciples, saying unto them, whom do men say that I am? And they answered, John the Baptist, but others, some say Elias, and others, one of the prophets. And he saith unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Peter answered and saith unto him, thou art the Christ. And he charged them that they should tell no man of him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things, and be rejected of the elders, and of the chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Father, we thank you for your word this morning to us as we have it opened here. We thank you, Lord, for the freedom that we have in our country to open your word. We thank you for the liberties that we have in our country to meet publicly. Even when we have various restrictions, we thank you that there are still open doors that we can come and we can gather. We pray, Father, for those Christians today that are unable to meet publicly. There are many across Canada today. Father, we pray that you would give them strength and give them help. Lord, we pray for the needs represented here today. We thank you, Lord, that Even though we were unable to meet in our regular place, Lord, there was a door open for us to continue to gather this morning. Lord, we rejoice that Jesus is alive. He rose victorious from the grave. But Father, we know that there are some heavy hearts today. We know, Father, there are many trials and difficulties that we face in this life. As was mentioned, that young girl today, Father, who's in hospital, we pray for her. We pray, Father, for her health and for her healing. Lord, we pray that the doctors would have wisdom as they try to find why she's having such a trouble. Lord, we ask that you would just intercede in that need right there. Lord, we also pray for the other needs represented here. There are some that aren't with us today. We pray you be with them where they are. We thank you, Father, for the ministry of the Open Bible Baptist Church, Lord, and for the access we have through the internet and for those that we're able to reach online. We pray, Lord, you be with each one. Lord, we just thank you today that we can have your word open and the gospel can continue to go forward. We pray for souls to be saved, for sinners to realize that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, as he said, and that we will rise again, that one day everyone will rise from the dead, because he is alive, he rose victorious. And Father, we thank you that we can be ready for that day. And today is the day of salvation in which we need to receive Christ and be ready. Father, we pray that you would continue to work in hearts and speak to us as we have your word open and we reflect on the resurrection today. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There are some that teach that Jesus merely became unconscious on the cross. And they took him and they put him in the tomb. And after some time of resting, he kind of revived. He didn't completely die. But we know that is not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that Jesus, he did not succumb to his injuries. The Bible says he yielded up the ghost. He literally dismissed his own spirit. The scripture says that he has power to, Jesus said, I have power to lay it down and power to take it again. Speaking of his life, this commandment have I received of my Father. And when we look at the tomb, the grave clothes, yes, they were there, the napkin folded in a place beside itself. The tomb is empty. The angels are there announcing he is not here, but he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay. And the foundation of Christianity and our salvation fully depends on the truth and the doctrine that Jesus died, was buried, and bodily rose again on the third day. And it wasn't just that Jesus rose again on the third day. That could have been enough. But he wanted to make sure that the whole world knew that he was alive. And so what did he do? He went out into the streets. He went to his disciples. He was seen of over 500 people at one time in his resurrected body. And we have lots of boys and girls here today. We didn't have our Sunday school class this morning, but maybe you can help me on this lesson. Can anybody remember what Thomas was able to do and able to see when he went to see Jesus? What did Thomas see on the body of Jesus after he was risen from the dead? What was that? The nail prints in his hands and his feet. And you know, for all of eternity, we're going to be able to see the prints in his hands and his feet. We are not going to feel our aches and our pains anymore when we're in heaven. We're not going to feel the sorrow of pain and loss. We're in a room today where that is the real thing. This is a room of great sorrow for many families. This is a room where families come in and they have great pain. All of that is going to be gone because Jesus rose again from the dead. And, you know, the only reminder we're going to have is those nail prints, and that's going to be what's all important Because if it wasn't for the nail prints, if it wasn't that Jesus gave himself for us, we would not have life. We would not have salvation so full and so free. And when we think of the bodily resurrection of Jesus, he spoke prior to the crucifixion that he was going to rise again. This wasn't a surprise to Jesus. He knew that he was going to the cross. That was the very purpose of his coming, was to lay down his life. But not only lay it down, but he was going to come back on the third day. And so the scripture foretells this. He speaks of that truth in verse 31. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. What hope they had even in that teaching. Yes, Jesus was going to endure things, and he spake that saying openly, and Peter took him and began to rebuke him. And when he turned about and looked on his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, "Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men." Peter couldn't imagine someone taking the Lord Jesus and rejecting him and treating him so cruelly and causing him to suffer and even putting him to death. But the Lord Jesus foretold his resurrection. But then over in the Gospel of John chapter 20, we have the very morning of the resurrection. A lot of events took place that morning. There was a lot of wonder. There was fear. There was unbelief even on the day of the resurrection. And there was great hope. John's Gospel, chapter 20 and verse 1. "The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. She runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciples whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, They have taken away the Lord unto the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him. Peter therefore went forth and that other disciple and came to the sepulchre. So they ran both together, and the other disciple did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulchre. And he stooping down and looking in, saw the linen clothes lying, yet not went in. And cometh Simon Peter following, and went into the sepulchre, and seeth the linen clothes lying, and the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. Then went in that also, that other disciple, which first came to the sepulchre, and he saw and believed. For as they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead, then the disciples went again to their own home." Now, Norman is here today. I'm going to take Norman's Bible because he was sharing something with me that I read earlier this week, and I want to share that with you. And we find in the scripture passage here, it says that the napkin was folded. Notice it says in verse 7, "And the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself." And it says here, the Gospel of John 20 verse 7 tells us the napkin which was placed over the face of Jesus was not thrown aside like the grave clothes. The Bible takes an entire verse to tell us the napkin was neatly folded and placed separate from the grave clothes. Early Sunday morning, while it was yet dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. She ran and found Simon Peter and the other disciple of whom Jesus loved. And she says, "They have taken away the body of the Lord, and we know not where they have laid him." And the scripture tells us these things. Then Simon Peter arrived. He goes inside and noticed the linen wrappings lying there, while the cloth that had covered Jesus' head was folded up and lying to the side. Why was that important? Or was that important? Absolutely. Was that significant? Yes, it was. And in order to understand the significance of the folded napkin, you must understand a little bit about Hebrew tradition of that day. The folded napkin had to do with the master and the servant. And every Jewish boy knew this tradition. When the servant set the dinner table for the master, he made sure that it was exactly the way the master wanted it. The table was furnished perfectly, And then the servant would wait just out of sight until the master had finished eating, and the servant would not dare touch that table until the master was finished. Now, if the master were done eating, he would rise from the table, wipe his fingers, his mouth, and clean his beard, and would wad up the napkin and toss it onto the table. The servant would then know to clear the table, for in those days the wadded napkin meant undone. But if the master got up from the table and folded his napkin and laid it beside his plate, the servant would not dare touch the table because the folded napkin meant something. It meant, I'm coming back. And the significance of the folded napkin and the truth that Jesus said, I would come again. And the truth that, yes, he rose from the dead, but that he is coming back. He is coming back. And that's the hope of us as Christians, that we know that he's coming back. Thank you, Norman, for sharing that with me this morning. And I had read that just a couple of weeks ago, and I thought I might share that, and then it kind of slipped my mind. And then the Holy Spirit obviously had Norman share that with me this morning, because I was going to share that today. But the significance of the folded napkin, not in the place where the other clothes were, but in a place folded by itself. Jesus is coming again. The Lord Jesus appeared to his disciples on the day of his resurrection, as we continue reading through in verse number 10. But Mary stood without at the sepulchre weeping, and as she wept, she looked down and looked into the sepulchre, and seeth two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. And they say unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. And Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing him to be the gardener, saith unto him, Sir, if thou hast borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus saith unto her, Mary. She turned herself and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Jesus saith unto her, Touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but I go to my brethren, and say to them, I ascend unto my Father and to your Father, and to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, and they had spoken these things to her. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst, and saith unto them, Peace be unto you. When he had so said, he showed to them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus unto them again, Peace be unto you, as my Father has sent me, even so send I you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. The Jews, there was great persecution, we know. The Lord Jesus was persecuted. They were looking for his disciples, the other followers of Jesus. We know that when Jesus gave himself to those that came to arrest him in the Garden of Gethsemane, all the disciples fled. We know that it was Peter that even denied that he knew the Lord 3 times. And so they're up in this area, in this room. The doors are closed. They're in fear. And Jesus comes. He enters into the room. He didn't have to open the door. He didn't have to knock. He just entered immediately into the room in his risen body. And he says unto them, Peace be unto you. And we have two words in verse number 19, which oftentimes grip us, especially the first one. Fear. Fear. The same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut for the disciples' words, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. You know, fear is a very paralyzing word. Fear can cause us to have great emotional difficulty. It can cause us to have physical problems. It can cause us to have great spiritual problems as well. We were looking at that in our Wednesday night message. How can we can be affected in many areas. and how the Lord wants to be able to replace fear with peace in our lives. And you know, there are many people in the world that are full of fear. And if you, all we have to do right now is turn on the news, and we can hear the fear that's being broadcast. As a result of COVID-19, there has been a fear that has swept over people like we probably have never seen in our generations. No doubt there was great fear when there was other diseases. There would have been great fear in the times of the war, the First and the Second World War. And there were times in there was news of London this past week, but in years gone by in London, we know that they would be in the blackout, and children would have to be in the bomb shelters with their families, and they wouldn't be allowed to turn on lights at night because it was a time of war, and they would be able to hear the planes flying over. And no doubt many prayers would be going up to the Lord for safety in those times of fear. But you know, we live in times of fear, and we can be fearful of just about anything. And Jesus wants to be able to replace that fear with his peace. And the Jews were, or the disciples were afraid of the Jews. And the first thing Jesus says to them is, "Peace be unto you." And he says it again. And notice verse 20, he says, "And when he had so said, he showed them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord." Notice how quickly that fear turns to gladness and peace. And Jesus said unto them again, "Peace be unto you. As my Father has sent me, even so send I you." And that's the resurrected Lord today. And that's what he's looking to do in each one of our lives. He's looking to take the fears that we experience down here, and he wants to be able to even help us in the midst of those fears and fill us with his peace. And how do we have peace? We sing many hymns about peace. "When peace like a river attendeth my way." You know, that hymn was written by a man who had experienced such great loss in his life, and no doubt had great fear about what was going to happen as a result of losing his family. "It is well with my soul," he could say. And another hymn writer who says, "Like a river glorious is God's perfect peace." Many times rivers are likened onto peaceful things. You go down this time of year, they're kind of high. We were down by the riverside last night, and we were looking, trying to see if there was any smelts that were going one way or the other. We didn't see anything, but we do know that the water's high this time of year. But you find a little stream and a nice peaceful trickle, and the leaves are going to begin coming out, and the beauty of all that, even in the Bible, it tells us that there's going to be a river, the river of life, which is going to flow through and from the throne of God and in the new heaven and the new earth. And we think of the glories of heaven, what peace there is. "He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water." There's so many pictures in the Bible about God's peace and strength that comes. "Peace be unto you." And so we think of the Lord's peace, wanting to replace fear with peace. Now, how can we do that practically in our lives? We're going to be faced with fear. They were full of fear at times. They were in this day, in the resurrection. This was supposed to be a day of rejoicing. This was supposed to be a day of gladness. But there was a day of fear. They were experiencing fear. You know, only through the Lord Jesus Christ can our fears be turned to peace. Can he take that fear away and fill us with his peace? How does that happen? Well, first of all, we know him as our personal Savior. That means there was a time in our life we invited the Lord Jesus Christ into our heart, repenting of our sin, believing that he died on the cross, was buried, and rose bodily from the grave on the third day, that his sacrifice was for our sin, for my sin. And by believing, faith alone upon him, for salvation, we have eternal life. And then as a Christian, we have God's Holy Spirit living inside of us. And so he indwells us. And that's God's working in us, his peace upon us. And we have the old nature that we have to yield ourselves away from and yield ourselves up to the Holy Spirit of God. And when we are tempted to be full of fear, we need to come to the Lord and say, "Lord, there are many things In your word, I don't know. But there are many things that I do know for sure. I know that the Spirit of the living God lives inside of me because I'm a Christian. I invited Jesus into my heart. And I know for sure that you would not have me as a Christian live in a state of fear, be overwhelmed and paralyzed by fear, but live in the by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me, and live by the power of the Holy Spirit of God who lives in us. And these teachings are all taught to us in God's word. His power is upon us, and that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power of love and of a sound mind. And if we have power, love, and a sound mind in our lives, that's going to help a great deal when it comes to those things that will cause us to fear. The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When God is our refuge and strength, the very present help in trouble. And so he calls them not to fear, but he calls them to have peace. Peace be unto you. And that is the message of the resurrection, that the Lord Jesus is alive and that he offers peace to the whole world, peace to a troubled world, peace to a world that's dying and lost and without hope without Jesus. He wants to be that answer for them. But you know what the resurrection also means to us? And the Lord Jesus appeared to many following his resurrection. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he appeared to over 500 at once. He ascended into glory following his resurrection in Acts chapter 1. And they witnessed his ascension. And the angel said, "Why stand ye gazing up into heaven? The same Jesus which has taken you into heaven, so shall come in like manner as ye have seen him taken up." And so that's the truth, that Jesus is coming again. And because he is alive, and because he is ascended, and because he has given a name which is above every name, that he has the power and the authority to cause all the dead to be brought back to life, and he will one day. We know he came to the tomb of Lazarus, and what did he say? Does any of the boys and girls remember what Jesus said that day when he came to Lazarus' tomb? He said, "Lazarus," did he say, "stay where you are," or did he say, "come forth"? Come forth. And Lazarus stayed right where he was, didn't he? Or did he get up and did he walk out of the tomb? Yeah, he was alive. And Jesus went to the tomb of Lazarus. He says, "Lazarus, come forth." And Lazarus had already been in the grave for a couple of days. You know, there might have been some people thinking, what is he doing? He wants us to open the door of the tomb. What is he doing? He's going to talk to someone who's dead in the grave. And here Lazarus comes forward, alive. And that's the power of Jesus. Jesus has the power to call all the dead to life. And he will one day. What will our resurrection look like? 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Because Jesus is risen, we too will raise one day. And because we have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation, we are going to raise on that day when the rapture of the church takes place. We are going to raise if we have died in the Lord Jesus. If we have, the rapture could happen today, we won't even need to be resurrected. We'll just be transformed because we're already alive. But those that have died in the Lord Jesus, their bodies will be raised. They will be resurrected. What will the resurrection look like? Notice verse 35. Some men will say, "How are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened except it die. And that which thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bare grain, that it may chance of wheat or some other grain. But God giveth it a body as it pleased him, to every seed his own body. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of man, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, another of birds. There are also celestial bodies and also terrestrial, but the glory of the celestial is one and the glory of the terrestrial is another. There is the glory of the sun and the glory of the moon and another glory of the stars, and one star differeth from another star in glory. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption, it is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam is made a quickening spirit. Howbeit that not the first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. The first man is of the earthy. The second man is the Lord from heaven. And as is the earthy, such is they also that are earthy. And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. Notice these verses. And as we have borne the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruption must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. The Apostle Paul, in living in his day, was anticipating the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, even in the hours in which he was living. Notice what he says. He says, we shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. And he says, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. He was looking forward to the change that was going to happen when Jesus was going to come back to the clouds. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? This sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Because Jesus is alive, because we have believed upon him for salvation, we are going to raise, if we die during this time before Jesus comes back, those that have died in the Lord Jesus are going to raise, and if we're alive, when he comes back, we're going to be changed. And it all stems from the truth that they came to the tomb that resurrection morning, the very early hours, and they did not find him there because he was risen. He is alive. And we do not serve a Savior this morning who just became unconscious, and they placed him in a tomb for him to get better. We have a Savior who died, who was buried, and who rose again. And there are other religions, many religions in the world today, and they're following after some leader who lived for so many years here and died, and they're buried in some grave somewhere. And that's who they're worshiping, someone who is dead. But we are worshiping today, and Jesus invites all the world and all those that are worshiping others to turn from all the idols and to turn to Jesus, who's alive and who's coming again. And that's the joy and the privilege we have as a Christian, to be able to share the gospel to those who do not know Jesus, that they would come to know him as personal Savior. And Jesus says, because I live, ye shall live also. And we are thankful that he's alive today. We're thankful that he is coming back, that that napkin was folded and placed in a place just by itself. He said, I'll be back. And he has a work yet to do. And until that time he comes, may we be faithful to the Lord this morning. Father, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for the challenge to our hearts. We pray, Father, that if there's any listening today that has never invited Jesus to become their personal Savior, to return of their sins, to find forgiveness of sin, Lord, we pray that today would be the day of salvation for them. And Lord, I pray that today would be a day we would all turn our eyes upon Jesus, that we would see him for who he is, that we would love him even greater, that we would desire to serve him. And Father, that we would honor thee with the remainder of the lives that you've given us, Lord. We thank you for the life and for the breath that we have today. It's all from you. Lord, help us to be faithful in these days and these hours. For it's in Jesus' name we pray and we ask. Amen. I'm going to invite you to take your songbooks. We're going to close together. Hymn number 546. And I want to thank you all for traveling out a little bit of further distance today for our service. We're just delighted that we could rejoice this morning in the cross and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. May that bring us great and tremendous assurance as we turn our eyes upon Jesus. Let's stand together as we close the service. Life everlasting, he passed, and we follow him there. Over us, sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. We're more than conquerors through him that loved us and gave himself for us. Let's just return thanks to him this morning. That fear with peace as he works in our hearts. Peace I leave with you, not as the world gives, give I unto you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid, Jesus said. Let's sing that third verse in closing.
His word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, his perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonder.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay, all next.